Hello, and welcome to another edition of Just an Opinion. This week I'm going to focus on the teen films from the 80s, but I'm going to focus specifically on the dramas. Now, understandably, there is some comedy in this film, so there is some carryover in tone. As far as my selections go, I'm focusing specifically on films that took place in the 1980s as I'm trying to capture the zeitgeist of the time period. So films like Stand By Me and The Outsiders, they're just not part of that since they're more period pieces. Now you may disagree with that, but remember, this is just an opinion. Let's go ahead and start the list. Number 10 is Permanent Record. Now this film deals with teen suicide. The focus of the movie starts with the character David, as he interacts with friends, family, and teachers. He seemingly has it all, so it's a complete surprise to everyone when he takes his own life.
It's rock and roll! David!
Now, it is my opinion that the camera's narration purposely deceived the audience a bit. David seemed normal, pressured, yes, but pretty much a guy who had his act together. I feel like this was an effective technique of the camera, basically showing everything more or less from his contemporaries' point of view, how they saw things with their interactions with David. Just an opinion. Thus, it was very effective that everyone was shocked at his sudden death. From this point, the flick shifts protagonists from David to Chris, brilliantly played by Keanu Reeves. On a side note, Reeves' early career is quite underrated, so I do highly recommend checking out some of his pre-Bill and Ted films. Chris becomes emotionally disjointed with his grief.
I should have known! I should have been the one that keep him from jumping! I was his best friend!
The only coherent thoughts he has are to try to pay tribute somehow to his best friend. But David's death is sadly met with ambivalence once people discover it was a suicide. Sadly, this was a reflection of the time period that the film took place in. Number 9 is Less Than Zero. Many times, teen dramas focus on the lower and middle class to make it more relatable to the audience. This film, however, focuses on an affluent group of adolescents just months removed from high school. While their parents' wealth afforded them an upgraded lifestyle, they still weren't emotionally mature enough to handle it. One of the movie's focuses is a love triangle. Andrew McCarthy plays Clay, an honest kid returning to LA from his East Coast college on winter break. To his dismay, his girlfriend Blair and his best friend Julian are now in a relationship. But sadly, both have also acquired an addiction to cocaine, as their post-high school dreams fizzled quickly.
Oh, Julian is a mess. He's out of control. You saw him.
You're not?
I can quit anytime. It's all the control I need.
I'm impressed.
Robert Downey Jr. gives a very emotional performance as Julian. His drug addiction has alienated him from everyone who he once cared about, as he is indebted to his drug dealer Rip, brilliantly played by everyone's favorite bully, James Spader.
I don't have any money. I don't know. I don't know where I'm gonna get it.
Julian, this cannot go on forever. You owe me a lot of cash, and I'm carrying you like I'm stupid.
I know, but if you just give me a chance, please don't cut me off. I'll do whatever you want, anything you want.
This film showcased how badly drug addiction damages and changes people in any tax bracket. While this material is pretty dismal, it is actually somewhat of a lighthearted adaptation of the original Bret Easton Ellis novel, which I also do highly recommend. Number 8 is Lucas. This film challenges conformity and the superficial nature of high school students. Corey Haim stars as the title character. He is unpopular and picked on, but it really has little effect on him. He befriends and develops feelings for the new girl, Andy, with hopes that she too wants to avoid the cliques and cliches of being popular. Unfortunately, that's not the case though. Andy does want to be her own person, but that includes going out for cheerleading, and developing feelings for high school football star Cappy. Lucas feels betrayed, and then rebels against his own principal and comports himself by trying out for the high school football team. This is not exactly met with approval and enthusiasm from the team. The finale comes with a big football game. While Lucas doesn't really make the impact that he was hoping for, he did take a stand, and in the process he earned everyone's respect. Was great in this role, and so was the supporting cast with a young Charlie Sheen and Winona Ryder. It's very reflective of what is considered so important in high school. And those who challenged or stayed away from this hierarchy were often ridiculed or social pariahs. Number 7 is Red Dawn. Like most kids in the 1980s, I learned about the Cold War from movies like Rocky IV and this one. This flick was pure propaganda, but enjoyable. It boasts an amazing cast featuring Patrick Swayze, Charlie Sheen, C. Thomas Howell, Leah Thompson, and many others. When Soviet troops invade the United States, the kids are turned overnight into soldiers and America's last hope.
308. Somebody get some lanterns.
38 special.
Grab some toilet paper.
Get that 12K.
I ain't gonna use no leaves.
Hey, grab the cookies.
I'm gonna
carry a lot of that.
That's the purification tablets. Start loading up.
Take a lot of batteries, boys.
Get the shotgun now.
Get those down jackets.
Well, I guess it's a good thing that they knew exactly what to do. Maybe they had high school assemblies on this. It's interesting, since this is basically a World War III picture, but children are charged with the task of defending America, as most of the adults have been taken captive already. Lord knows I would not want to be in that predicament now, considering today's youth. At its release, and even today, the film sparks the argument whether it was a far-right fantasy film or just a simple work of fiction. Whether it glorifies war or not, it's not without its extreme and very emotional moments. The flick is very violent, and unfortunately, not all the kids make it in the end. Number 6 is River's Edge. This is quite an upsetting film featuring a great cast including Keanu Reeves, Ione Skye, Crispin Glover, and many others. Upon the discovery that one classmate murdered another, the ensemble all react differently, but mostly with denial and apathy. Only Glover shows any real type of emotion, but he clumsily tries to cover up the murder.
Got a lot of people here. Bury her so she's never found.
Okay, we're just gonna drive around here a little while. We're gonna see if we can't figure this thing out. We're gonna have to get you out of town somehow.
There was a remarkable absence of parental guidance, which somewhat explains the lack of feelings and actions of the teenagers. Most of the kids are beyond reach at this point. There is also a subplot involving Reeves' younger brother, Tim, who is slowly heading towards that path, as the only emotions he shows are anger and rage. This film is very dark. It's quite sad how a youth's murder garnered such mixed reactions.
He murders Jamie and we just ignore it?
He had his reasons. She was shooting her mouth off about his mom.
His mother's dead.
Yeah. See?
He's got a couple loose springs when it comes to dealing with his dead mother.
But he comes to school bragging. It's like he wants to get caught.
But ultimately, selfishness reigns supreme, as no one said anything, as they were more concerned with how it would impact them. Number 5 is The Legend of Billie Jean. The destruction of a scooter leads to an accidental shooting. But a group of teens refuse to turn themselves in until they receive restitution for the damages. On the run from the law, they refuse to compromise their principles. And along the way, they trigger an uprising amongst the local youth once their side of the story is released. So this movie is really silly, but really awesome at the same time. It was pretty cool to see Billie Jean transition from innocent teen to a rebellious and inspiring leader taking cues from Joan of Arc. In many ways, this movie is a precursor to the impact of social media as their side of the story goes viral on multiple television stations.
From now on, we're doing this our way.
Lying, no cheating, fair is fair.
All right.
$608 for the scooter your son trashed. That's what you owe, and we're not turning ourselves in till we get it. Fair is fair. We didn't start this, we didn't mean it to happen, but we're not giving up till you pay. Fair is fair. Yeah!
Helen Slater put on a Supergirl of a performance, not backing down from the wily Hubie Pyatt and his nasty father, Mr. Pyatt.
You don't even know what a pig you are. For my trouble, or to keep my mouth shut, or maybe for a few minutes in your room upstairs, how much is that worth to you, Mr. Pyatt? Tell us! Everyone's listening.
Here's your change.
Christian Slater was also great as her rambunctious brother Binks, who is not really her brother in real life despite the same last name. The movie also had a great 1980s soundtrack featuring Billy Idol, The Divinyls, and of course Pat Benatar with the theme song Invincible. Number 4 is Heathers. While a blatant satire, this film is also a commentary on teen suicide and high school hierarchy. There's a constant shift between scenes that are relatable to the average person's high school experience, to revenge fantasies that most could only imagine.
What about, like, milk and orange juice? What's the upchuck factor on that?
I'm a no-rest build-up man myself.
Don't be a dick. Stuff will kill her.
Winona Ryder and Christian Slater are great in this film, showcasing conflicting emotions of conforming or rebelling against social norms. It was fascinating, yet disturbing, how suicide could turn a polarizing individual into a martyr.
Same things. It's just not going to be the same here without her.
What are you talking about? You hated her, she hated you.
Every English class, I look forward to seeing her.
Heather Chandler's more popular than ever now.
Scary stuff.
Whether it's laughing or utter shock, the visceral response to this film is usually preceded by the word uncomfortable. This film is typically mentioned in any 1980s teen film discussion. It was recently remade as a television series, and if you want an interesting switch, check out the Broadway musical. It's actually really entertaining. Number 3 is Dream a Little Dream. On the surface, this appears to be another Corey movie from the 80s. But there's actually some good substance within. Corey Feldman takes the lead as the shiftless Bobby. I guess he was a boy that was kinda lost? Meanwhile, Jason Robards plays Coleman, a genuine man trying to find a way to stay with his wife even beyond their mortal lives. With a big dosage of suspension of disbelief, Coleman actually manages to switch bodies with Bobby, but the latter remains in a dreamlike purgatory state. With some pretty heavy material here, Corey Haim is the comic relief of the film playing Dinger.
You alright?
Yeah, I'm fine, thank you.
What did I leave me in there for? I could've got my ass kicked. I didn't though, it was brilliant.
What?
So I did, kung fu shit. I need a stiff drink.
You gotta go to school, it's a dirty job. Someone's gotta do it, okay? School, you know? School? Hey buddy, school's that way, yonder.
Feldman showed off some real acting chops here, playing an old man trapped in a teenager's body. His plight shifts to reuniting with the love of his life, also trapped inside a teenager's body, also trying to direct Bobby towards a brighter future. Body swapping films, wow, that sounds kind of weird, were mostly played off for laughs. But this film tapped into the drama of it, particularly adolescents acting on emotion and making impulsive decisions that could affect you for the rest of your life.
Why do we have to take something so far that it can't be taken back? I'll tell you why.
because we're young. And when you're young, every little thing seems so big. Joel, you've got a gun. Do you understand that? You got a gun, Joel.
While not well received, this film really developed a cult following later, and it has an amazing soundtrack. Number 2 is Say Anything. Very few teen love stories elicit the responses that this film triggers. John Cusack was the personification of endearing in his 1980s film performances. In this flick, the relationship he forms with Diane is seen as true love for him, but a summer fling to her since she'll be leaving for college in the fall. From the beginning, you can see how caring Cusack is towards her with his affection and his protective instincts.
Just felt safer that way, you know?
Watch out for that glass.
Thanks. But either way, it's still...
twisted.
You know what? What? You're a great date.
As her feelings turn more serious, she surprisingly breaks things off with him. At times, this film is almost hard to watch as you see Cusack's almost literal heartbreak. For me in particular, the scene that's hardest to watch is how Cusack pleads to Diane to destroy a letter he wrote to her.
I don't know, I've been thinking about these things, you're probably standing there monitoring. So just one other thing, the letter that I wrote you, could you please rip it up? Nuke it, flame it, destroy it. It hurts me to know it's out there. Can you do that for me? All right, later.
Hello?
I can definitely identify with this pain. Sheesh. One time, as an act of affection, I recorded myself singing On the Wings of Love for a girl. But that is something that we're never going to discuss again. Moving on. The flick also has one of the most iconic romantic scenes in film history. All Cusack had to offer was within his heart. And if he couldn't find the right words to use, he found the best way he could to express himself. Number 1 is The Karate Kid. Some 80s movies should be required viewing, and The Karate Kid is right there at the top of the list. At its core, it deals with a troubled teen learning the disciplines of karate, not only to help him defend himself against a gang of bullies, but also to guide him through life. In the heart of this film was Mr. Miyagi, perhaps one of cinema's greatest mentor figures. One of Miyagi's most important lessons to Daniel was balance.
You prove a point.
No, what point? That I can take a beating? I mean, every time I see those guys, they're gonna know they got the best of me. I'll never have balance that way. Not with them, not with Allie. Not with me.
Similar to Miyagi's lesson to Daniel-san, the film is very well balanced, in terms of the focus being mostly on Daniel's growth and maturity. But that tournament scene does give us that sweet bit of vicarious revenge as Daniel defeats the Cobra Kai's one by one. Constantly mentioned in film history, but as far as pop culture is concerned, it has some pretty interesting fan theories. The top mentioned proposal is that Daniel was actually the bully. For the most part though, I disagree with this idea considering how many times Daniel was put in a 5-on-1 situation. But it's this fandom that kept the movie alive decades after its release and had a hand in creating the Cobra Kai Redux series. And as an enormous fan of the source material, this was a fan person's dream come true. Thank you so much for watching, and please do leave a comment. I'll be back soon with part 3 of this series, but I'm going to change it from drama to comedy. So until then, remember to sweep the leg, be careful of a gang of Heathers, and fair is fair!